Good day. When will I be able to get that vaccine or join my family at a wonderful meal out in a restaurant or do that travel that's been so contained? All those unanswered questions. And yet we gather here at St. Hilary Church in St. Padre Pio Parish in Chicago, we gather here and hear the words of the scripture. It is good to be here, the apostles say as they encounter Jesus on the mountain. So it is good that we can be here at least. We can be here, really here with the Lord and sharing our faith with each other no matter where we are. This is not something we wait for, we have it. And so we begin in the name of the Father, the Son, with the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. As we enter into the second week of Lent, we are still maybe placing ourselves in a place where the Lord can lead us to new growth in faith. And so we pause and welcome God's presence.
Sent to heal the contrite of heart. Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison. You came to call sinners. Christe eleison, Christe eleison. Seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins. Bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading is from Genesis, is one of the hardest. It's that moment when Abraham is ready to sacrifice his son, his only son, Isaac. Perhaps part of Abraham was still attached to the old God, which at times encouraged human sacrifice. What we learn in this reading, among other things, is that we learn more, not that much about Abraham's consistent faith, but about who God is, this new God that Abraham is still trying to figure out. In our second reading, Paul, speaking to the Romans and their struggle, assures them that God will not let them go. As we listen to that second reading, you might be alert to try to take at least one phrase from that reading. Keep that with you when you find yourself in a difficult situation. That's the way the Lord will be with you from that letter at that time.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son Isaac, your only one whom you love, and go into the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you." When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He then reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand upon the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your only beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding your son from me, your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I trusted even when I said, "I am sorely afflicted." How precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his faithful. "Your servant, Lord, your servant am I, the son of your handmaid. You have loosened my bonds. A thanksgiving sacrifice I make. I will call on the name of the Lord. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. My vows to the Lord I will fulfill before all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living."
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? Christ Jesus it is who died, or rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to you, the word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. May the Lord be in our minds, spoken from our lips, and live in our hearts. Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became dazzling white, such as no fuller on earth could bleach them. Then Elijah appeared to them, along with Moses, and they were conversing with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter hardly knew what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down from the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone except when the Son of Man had been risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord. My highest literal mountaintop experience was making it up over 14,000 feet to Mount Evans in Colorado. There are all kinds of mountaintop experiences. In his autobiography, James Irwin, one of the astronauts who went to the moon, wrote, "As we flew into space, we had a new sense of ourselves, of the earth, and of the nearness of God. We were outside ordinary reality. I sensed that there was a beginning of some sort of deep change taking place within me." An astronaut, James Irwin, goes on to describe that mountaintop experience for him. "The ultimate effect has been to deepen and strengthen all the religious insight I ever had. On the moon, the total picture of the power of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, became abundantly clear to me." We may not be traveling to the moon, but Lent tries to evoke from us some kind of mountaintop experience. Even in fasting, we learn that our body uses most of its energy in an effort to digest food. So if we take that bodily function and slow it down, we have energy, maybe energy to release some of the Spirit of God within us or in the work we do. What is a mountaintop experience? The word transfigure in the Greek ultimately gives us the word metamorphosis, that change that comes about. There's something that changes in us. As Peter, James, and John were coming down from the mountain experience, it's as if Jesus at that point would give them a t-shirt, maybe give it to us as well, and it says, "God's not finished with me yet." Certainly the disciples had a long way to go to understand who Jesus was and their relationship to him. I remember one, as it were, mountaintop experience in Jerusalem. In one of the churches right outside the old wall of Jerusalem, St. Peter in Calicantu. On top of that church, there's a rooster, because this is the spot where Peter denied Jesus three times. Calicantu means the cowing cock. And one thing I noticed about that place that really struck me was that they had found in the church subterranean area what could have been an underground passage to an underground prison. And it possibly was there that Jesus spent that night after he had been condemned and walked by Peter as Peter condemned him. I had never really thought before about that night, where Jesus was. And to go into that place, and then they turned the lights out, to have that sense that maybe Jesus was here. What was he thinking about? Did he think about any of us? For me, that was one of those mountaintop experiences. But we can spot mountaintop experiences even on this flat land of Chicago. Those times when, maybe surprisingly, we sit down and there's a wonderful dinner there, or a conversation that goes on through the night. Maybe it's a book club and you've really tapped into something that has touched people. That mountaintop experience can come from good art, from literature or music or paintings that just stir our spirit up, or just the appeal of nature. Just appreciating God's wonderful creation around us. The prayer time we spent in Lent, that quiet time with God, can lead us to something very special. We might look at and try to retrieve some of those mountaintop experiences from the past. I suggest maybe you look through a photo album, pictures of yourself at your different age. What does that evoke from you? You look at your physical appearance. If you have enough of those pictures, that appearance changes. Does it parallel what was going on inside of you at that time? What was happening? What truths became more what was steering you now in your life? Abraham, Peter, James, and John were unfinished and chose to let God lead them. Do we have the same faith and trust to say, here I am, Lord, meet me here, work with me, move me where you want me to go? In the opening lines of Mary Oliver's poem, Wild Geese, we have one perspective on where we might find that mountaintop experience. The opening lines, you do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert repenting. You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. You don't have to be good to experience God's closeness, to find that place where maybe the urging of your body just says, I got to get up from this screen I've been at for hours and stretch, or that sense, I gotta call my family now, I don't have to wait. How is God reaching out to you, trying to show you that when you say, here I am, we begin to hear where God is taking us? Years later, after that mountaintop experience, Peter expressed something about it in his second letter. He says, "For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty when a voice came from God the Father. We ourselves heard the voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain." May there be a time this Lent when you are with the Lord in some sacred place. You hear him speak. You know you are having a mountaintop experience. We hold ourselves to the Lord as Peter witnessed in his memory of that time with the Lord on the mountain. We hold all that together as we profess, "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection and the life of the world to come. Amen." Lord, on this Lenten journey again, we turn to you for those inklings that you are guiding us. And so, Lord, again, enter our petitions and enter our Lenten journey.
For missionaries and caregivers who serve abroad and at home, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders of industry, may they be conscientious toward stewards of the earth's resources. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are experiencing a crisis of faith, may they be inspired by Abraham's witness of faith in God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are facing mountains of doubt or anxiety, may they gain knowledge and assurance through Scripture. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this church community and the challenges we face, especially those who feel they lack the gifts to share time and talent, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the intentions of this Mass, and especially for all our parishioners, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, continue to clue us in through our body and our reactions to the opportunities of the moment to find you, to serve each other, and to build your kingdom. We pray this through Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray then, brothers and sisters, students, boys and girls, that these gifts be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father and Creator. May the sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind for the celebration of the Paschal festivities through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told the disciples of his coming death on the holy mountain, he manifested to them his glory to show, even by the testimony of the law and the prophets, that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and freely entered his passion, Jesus took bread, he blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Blaise our Bishop, with all the clergy and all people who seek your Lenten guidance. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, Saint Padre Pio, Saint Hilary, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant us peace in our day, that with the help of your mercy, we may be free from all sin and safe from all distress, as we await in blessed hope the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you say to your disciples everywhere, my peace I give you, my peace is with you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you. We share with someone either very close to us now or someone we encounter the gift of Christ's peace. Peace. Peace.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccato mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccato mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccato mundi, dona nobis pacem.
Here is Christ, God's goodness near us, and blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
In your death we are reborn. Though you die in all of history, still you rise with every morn. Still you rise with every morn. Seed that dies to rise in glory, may we see ourselves in you. If we learn to live your story, we may die to rise anew. We may die to rise anew. We remember truth once spoken, love passed on through act and word. Every person lost and broken, where's the body of the Lord? Where's the body of the Lord?
Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to you, O Lord, for allowing us, while still on earth, to be partakers even now of the things of heaven through Christ our Lord. You're invited to continue to connect with our parish of St. Padre Pio through our website, stpadrepioparish.org, for future events and information that may help you on your Lenten journey. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Bless your faithful, we pray, O Lord, with a blessing that endures forever, and keep them faithful to the gospel of your only begotten Son, so that they may always desire and at last attain the glory whose beauty he showed in his own body to the amazement of his apostles through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We've gathered where the Lord has taken us and invited us. We go forth now in his blessing. And let's be church after church.
Christ, you lead and we shall follow, stumbling though our steps may be. One with you in joy and sorrow, with a river you